you very much. That was the Reading Community Singers, and a very great message there. We do have a lot to be thankful for here today. I'd like to welcome Reverend Jamie Michaels from the Old South United Methodist Church to start us off with a blessing this morning.
Good morning. Will you pray with me? Holy God of all the nations, we give you thanks this day for the opportunity to be in your presence, to show the community and to show the world what our hearts are made of, hearts that are built of love and justice, the kind of love and justice that you have taught us by seeing our brothers and sisters from around the world come together in peace. We ask that today, on a day when we remember losing the lives of so many, that you would turn our hearts and our minds to a higher cause. That when the world asks of us vengeance, we return to the world love. That when the world asks of us war, we return to it peace. And that you, O God of all the nations, would bless us with peace, lands afar and lands that are ours. In your many holy names we pray this day. Amen.
Thank you very much. My name is Brian Snell, and I am the chairperson of the Reading Fall Street Fair, and I'm also an attorney of the street. But we'd like to welcome you all here today, and thank you for celebrating with us and remembering the events of September 11th. I'd like to welcome Deputy Chief David Clark to give us some remarks.
On it, go. Hold on.
Good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank everybody for taking time out to help us remember and honor the victims of 9/11. When I reflect back on that day, I remember not feeling of despair and not sadness, but anger and an overwhelming willingness and an overwhelming wantingness to help. And I didn't know what to do to help, but I knew I wanted to do something to help out that day. Later on, when Chief Silva stated that they're looking for volunteers to go down and help out in New York City, I jumped up the opportunity to go down there and fulfill that need to help and feel like I could do something for the people down there. The time I went down there with, at the time, was Sergeant Cormier. I spent 3 days down at the site helping transport the crisis management teams to and from wherever they needed to go to help out with people. And one, the lasting thing I have down there is a remembrance of how appreciative everybody was of our time and our services down there, and how everybody together from all different walks of life came together to help serve a single purpose. And that's something that's gonna stay with me for the rest of my life. That overwhelming camaraderie that we had, cohesiveness to get the job done. And I was just thankful I had the opportunity to do something to help out and give back to what happened down there. One memory that's gonna stay with me for the rest of my life is when I knew we were down at the site of the towers one day, and we were standing down at the site, and I remember looking up, just slightly up off to my left, at a building that had the whole wall missing. And I could see the desks, I could see the office furniture, and one office in particular, I could see the blades of a ceiling fan slowly moving around in the wind, and I could see the papers blowing in the wind that were on the top of the filing cabinet. It was an eerie feeling, a feeling that would live me the rest of my life. I remember standing there, and I must have been standing for a long time looking at it, because one of the firefighters from New York walked up to me, pointed to the office, and said, "That office you're looking at right now is on the 7th floor of that building." And that's when it hit me how big the devastation was, because where I was standing was only about 15 to 20 feet above my head. And that's when it kind of hit me of how massive the devastation was. And I tell you, that's one memory that's going to live with me for the rest of my life. So that's when I thank everybody for coming up today to help us honor and remember commemorate those victims of 9/11. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Chief Clark. I'd like to welcome the Irish American Police Officers Association Pipes and Drums and the Westford Fire Regional Pipe Band and their rendition of Amazing Grace. Thank you. much. I'd like to welcome Senator Jason Lewis to the stage.
Thank you very much for joining us on this important occasion. It's an honor for me to be with you along with Representative Dwyer, Representative Jones, Town Manager LaLesure, and our other distinguished guests. I want to start by just thanking Brian Snell and the other members of the committee that organized this commemoration today. I think it's very special that the town of Reading is doing this today, one of the few communities in the area, in fact, and for all the work organizing the Fall Street Fair as well. Thank you. I also want to thank Deputy Chief Clark, who just shared with us his very moving personal experience and his sacrifice in going down to Ground Zero. Thank you, Deputy Chief. So 15 years may have passed, but the passage of time does not really diminish how viscerally we all recall the tragic events that took place on September 11th, 2001. The pain, the sense of loss for the families that lost their loved ones on that awful day is still very, very real. The wound in our nation's psyche may never fully heal. The horror that was unleashed by the terrorists on 9/11, the image that so many of us hold in our mind of the Twin Towers in New York City collapsing and taking with them so many thousands of innocent lives, is seared forever in our collective memory. But what I also recall vividly from that time is how we as a nation responded in the aftermath of the attacks. The courage and the selflessness of the first responders, like Deputy Chief Clark. The strength of our leaders at that time. The spirit of generosity and of kindness and of love displayed by so many toward their fellow Americans, even those they had never met before. You know, the new freshman class this year at Reading High School and high schools around the country is the first class of high school students born after 9/11. These students will read about these events in their history books, like my generation learned about Pearl Harbor. But we need to make sure that through ceremonies like this one today, they also hear firsthand accounts and personal recollections of what happened on 9/11 and in the aftermath. Today, when our civic life and our politics can be, sadly, rancorous and divisive, it is easy for us to dwell on our differences and on what divides us. But we should not forget that what we share as Americans is much deeper and more profound than anything that divides us. As Sandy Dahl, the wife of Flight 93 pilot Jason Dahl, said, "If we learn nothing else from this tragedy, we learn that life is short and there is no time for hate." Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Lewis. I'd like to welcome the Reading Community Singers in their rendition of Omnia Soul.
To become, for knowing God above.
very much. I'd like to welcome Representative Brad Jones.
Good morning, everyone. I'm honored to be here to join with you to observe the 15th anniversary of the September 11th attacks. Like Senator Lewis, I want to commend the town of Reading for making this commemoration part of its Reading Fall Street Fair, being one of the few communities in the Commonwealth to make the time and to take the time to remember a very, very important point in our history. Today is a day for reflection and remembrance. For those of us old enough to remember exactly where we were on September 11th, 2001, none of us will ever forget. 15 years ago today, our country's values and principles came under attack, and thousands of lives were senselessly taken. We must never forget that day, and we must always strive to honor the many innocent lives that were taken from us. One U.S. Senator said of September 11th, it was one of our worst days, but it brought out the best in us. It unified us as a country and showed our charitable instincts and reminded us of what we stood for and stand for. On September 11th, we saw countless acts of compassion, heroism, and caring as individuals rushed to the aid of complete strangers to assist and comfort them. And many, too many of our emergency responders sacrificed their own lives that day to save others. And all too sadly, September 11th confirmed that there is evil in this world. But it proved resoundingly that good can and will triumph over evil. Today we gather as families, as a community, more importantly as Americans, to remember those who lost their lives on September 11th, 2001. As we pause to reflect on this somber anniversary, let us keep the families of the victims, the first responders, and the servicemen and women who continue to protect us in our thoughts and prayers each and every day. Please join me in thanking our police and firefighters for the amazing work they continue to do day in and day out to keep us all safe. Thank you. Today we remember September 11th, 2001. We will never forget. God bless our community, our Commonwealth, and our country. Thank you.
Representative Jones. I'd like to welcome Representative James Dwyer and Captain Mark Dwyer of the Reading Fire Department.
Thank you very much for joining with us today to honor and remember the victims, their families, the first responders, and the folks who arrived at ground zero, so to speak, in the memory of everybody that was there. It's an honor for me, and I want to thank the community of Reading, the town officials, and Brian Snell and your committee, Brian, for putting on a great event here today. In what seems to be 15 long years ago, our country changed by one of the darkest moments in our nation's history. We were faced with tragedy, uncertainty, questions about who and why this would happen. People across the world wondered how Americans would respond and how a nation would rebuild. True to our enduring spirits, since the formation of our great nation, we rose from the ashes of that day anew, resilient, and defiant, not allowing a tragedy to define our future, but rising to the opportunity to let our response, resiliency, and enduring hope of prosperity define how we return to our everyday lives. In memory of those civilians whose lives were lost and the first responders who perished in their efforts to save the innocent, requires a devotion to their cause that was honored through our resiliency by rising above the tribulations we faced following 9/11. It is in that spirit, the true American spirit, which makes our democracy and our freedom endure when facing the most challenging of times. Today, remember those whose lives were lost on that fateful September day, and we honor their memories by continuing on with our lives and with the great pride in our nation. It is with very humble, my next duty here today is to very proudly introduce to you my cousin Mark. He's a captain with the, Mark Dwyer, the captain with the Reading Fire Department, who's gonna share some personal memories of family in 9/11 and responding to Ground Zero as a responder on that very fateful tragedy. Mark.
Senator Jason Lewis, Representative Brad Jones and James Dwyer, Town of Reading Board of Selectmen, Town Manager Mr. Bob LaLasher, clergy members, Chief Sagala and Burns, and members of the public safety community, and townspeople of Reading, good afternoon. On behalf of the Reading Fire Department, thank you for being here today, and thank you to Brian Snell and his committee for organizing this remembrance ceremony. I will be sharing with you some thoughts about 9/11 from the perspective of one who lost a family member that day and who also worked at Ground Zero in the days following the attack. Before I do that, I would like to honor the memory of 343 brother firefighters, 60 New York City and Port Authority police officers, 8 paramedics, and 31 public safety officials who saved thousands of civilian lives during the attack at the World Trade Center. I would also like to honor the memory of 4,505 U.S. American troops who have lost their lives fighting for our protection in Operation Iraqi Freedom, and another 2,384 military personnel who have lost their lives fighting in Afghanistan during Operation Enduring Freedom. I invite you to visit the Home Base Program booth at the Reading Town Fair today to speak with my good friends, Brigadier General Jack Hammond and Mike McMillan, who have been doing tremendous work helping our veterans upon their return home from war. One in every three veterans returning home suffer from post-traumatic stress, traumatic brain injuries, or other invisible wounds of war, and they need our support. It is an honor to remember the 2,977 innocent victims killed in the 9/11 terrorist attack, 246 of whom were on airplanes, 125 who worked at the Pentagon, and the remaining 2,606 who were in New York City at the World Trade Center complex, where my cousin Kevin McCarthy worked. The McCarthy family were longtime Reading residents, with all 6 children graduating from Reading Memorial High School, Kevin from the class of 1978. Kevin was an extraordinary man with a great sense of humor and passion for life. A successful entrepreneur, he owned his own livery business for many years after graduating from high school. Kevin served in the National Guard for 6 years and continued his educational pursuits at Bunker Hill Community College and Northeastern University. He was an accomplished tennis and hockey player, and a humble and kind gentleman. An avid fisherman, he found paradise on Cape Cod as a boy, and years later, it was there where he brought his own family to vacation. Kevin married the love of his life, Deborah, and became the father of 3 wonderful children. His strong work ethic was evident throughout his life, and he was not someone afraid to take risks. While residing in California, Kevin stayed at home to care for his twins, Stephanie and Andrew, after they were born, and served in the school's PTO and coached children's soccer. After he moved his family to Connecticut, he embarked on a promising career as a bond trader. At the time of the attack, Kevin was working for Cantor Fitzgerald, located on the 104th floor of the North Tower. Cantor Fitzgerald lost every one of the 658 employees working that day. I invite you to visit the memorial located at the front of Reading Memorial High School, honoring all those who lost their lives on 9/11, including Kevin. I am forever grateful to John Doherty, our school superintendent, and to the Town of Reading Fire and Police and Public Works Departments, and community member and past selectman James Bonazzoli, who who were all instrumental in helping build the beautiful 9/11 memorial and its dedication ceremony in 2011. I am also eternally grateful to those who contributed financially to help make the memorial a reality, a true testament to the commitment that the Reading community has shown towards its residents and those who lost their lives on 9/11. While no other event in recent times has shaped the lives of this generation more than the attacks on 9/11, my message to you today is not about the horror of the attack, but rather a message of kindness, patriotism, and hope as I reflect on my experiences there. I cannot possibly put into words the incredible goodness that people exhibited in New York City while I was there. When I first arrived in New York 2 days after the attack, I spoke to a New York City police officer in the Bronx near Yankee Stadium. I explained to him that I was a firefighter and there to find more information about my cousin and to work at Ground Zero. He wrote his name, badge number, and another ID number on a piece of paper and told me to put it on my car's dashboard and to park behind some sawhorses nearby, assuring me that my vehicle would be safe there, and it was. You may remember that no one was being allowed in the city, that the fear of another attack was uncertain, and that additional buildings were threatening to collapse. I expected to be met with challenges upon my arrival, and this officer alleviated much of that concern. My first stop after taking a train was Chelsea Piers, where a triage center had been set up. I had hoped to find someone to assist me in finding more information about Kevin, but instead I was asked some very personal questions about my cousin that I did not have the answers to. Lamenting across the street in a park about how I was going to address these questions by phone with my cousin's wife, Deborah, a man must have seen my dismay and sat down next to me on a bench, despite several other benches being empty nearby. He greeted me and we began talking. He had been a New York City paramedic for 14 years, but had recently changed occupations. I told him I had come to New York City, and he offered his telephone number and address, welcomed me to stay with him and his wife for as long as I needed to. When I left that park, a police officer who had directed me there was waiting for me to come out. Having told him earlier about the telephone call I needed to make, he then said to me, "I want to tell you a story." He explained that his brother was an aide for one of the fire chiefs whom he drove into Ground Zero. His brother was told by the chief to get out of the area and wait for further orders, which he did. He said the collapse of the tower happened 10 minutes later and that the chief saved my brother's life. The Jacob Javits Center was where they were organizing rescue workers to go into Ground Zero. I took a cab there, and the driver asked if I was going to work there. When I told him that I was, he said, "This one's on me." And he told me how proud he was of what the rescue workers were doing there. I was loaded into an open-backed military vehicle with 9 guys, including several from Bedford Hills, New York, who were all carrying radios. I will never forget the ride to Ground Zero, the number of ambulances lined up along the route. People lined up along the outsides of the Jersey barriers and chain link fence, holding signs and banners of gratitude and yelling and clapping for us as we headed to Ground Zero. When we stopped, people would throw Gatorades, bottles of water, and power bars over the fence, thanking us for our service. It was the most patriotic I ever felt in my life. Inside Ground Zero, the compassion amongst the rescue workers was no different. So many people risking their lives in the hope of saving another. I knew as soon as I entered there, life as I knew it would never be the same. The lines of firefighters and other rescue personnel handing 5-gallon buckets up and down the pile. The eerie quiet, and then the lightning and thunder and deluge of rain. The glass falling from the blown out windows of surrounding buildings. Climbing up the pile, looking for victims, and dragging down large entanglements of wires and other wreckage. An iron worker using his torch, 30 stories high in an adjacent building. Police, construction workers, and military personnel pitching in the rescue effort. The battalion chief using the bullhorn, yelling for everybody to get off the pile when the steel columns or what remained of the tower walls began to squeal. running down the pile with hundreds of other guys, looking for cover, despite there being none. The technical rescue crews listening for victims in the void spaces. The complete silence by the responders stopping in their tracks when the battalion chief asked for quiet on the bullhorn, when the technical rescue people thought they heard something down inside the pile. Americans simply doing anything and everything they could to make a difference under very dire circumstances. After working through the night and leaving Ground Zero the following morning, two officers and a cruiser insisted on driving me to the Leo House Hotel, even though it was only a short walk. Thanks to the volunteers at Chelsea Piers, they were able to get me a bed there. The two officers expressed their gratitude and we shared condolences as they told me about people they knew who were missing, including their friends on the police department. Later that day, after getting a couple hours sleep, I noticed a folder on the desk about the Leo House Hotel. As I opened it and read, I learned that the Leo House was a nonprofit organization and provided a place for families of cancer victims to stay while they were visiting their loved ones. Having witnessed such destruction and feeling so much anguish, it was comforting to know that there was a place of such goodness. I will never forget the true American spirit I witnessed at Ground Zero and in the weeks following. Reading firefighters attended many funerals in the aftermath of the attacks to honor our 343 fallen brothers and their families, as did fire and police departments across our great country. Americans were extremely generous, donating funds to help the victims and their families try to recover financially from the tragedy. The outpouring of support, both emotional and financial, was remarkable. Shortly after 9/11, George W. Bush made the comment, "Time is passing, yet for the United States of America, there will be no forgetting September the 11th. We will remember every rescuer who died in honor. We will remember every family that lives in grief." Today, to do just that, a beautiful memorial and museum exists at Ground Zero, honoring all those who lost their lives and to remember them for how they lived. The town of Reading and communities all across our great nation are remembering those lost today. I ask that you please keep all the families who grieve the loss of their loved ones on this day in your prayers. I ask that you remember our military people and their families who continue to keep us safe from harm. I ask that you remember and pray for those who have sacrificed their life working at Ground Zero and who are sick today from the effects of working there long after the original attack. While we will never forget the horror of the attacks on 9/11, it is also important to remember our true American heroes and ordinary citizens who provide hope, showed kindness and courage, and a patriotism that overshadows all evil. It is what makes America great and ensures that we will overcome our enemies, providing a bright future for our children and grandchildren. I hope you have a great day today at the Reading Town Fair. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Dwyer and Captain Dwyer. I'd like to welcome Reverend Lisa Stedman from the First Congregational Church of Reading.
Let us join in the spirit of prayer and thanksgiving. God of all people, Holy One of all nations, we give you thanks for this time to gather and to remember, to honor the spirit of those who were lost this day many years ago, to honor those who seek to help every day in every place. We pray, gracious God, that you would bless us that we may honor the sacrifices and the service of others with our own sacrifices and our own service, that all people may know freedom, justice, and peace in our world. Amen.
Thank you very much. That concludes our ceremony for the day. We would like to welcome the Reading Community Singers and all of you in joining us in the national anthem. Please enjoy the fair.